Let's start our journey today by traveling back in time to the Stone Age, around 10,000 BC. And if you don't know what period I'm talking about, just think of the Flintstones. It is caveman Fred and his wife Wilma that started technological revolution, farming, and most notably the farming of wheat. Through the ages, the cultivation and consumption of wheat increases and is spread all over the world. Now, we fast forward to something like 2008. There's more awareness around celiac disease and gluten, which is present in barley, rye, and wheat. This results in a completely new revolution, and this time, gluten intolerance is spread all over the world. Or so it seems. The thing is, a lot of people think they are gluten intolerant, but they don't really know for sure. This is due to the inadequate diagnosis of this intolerance. Currently, the best way to determine if you are gluten intolerant is to remove gluten from your diet, and please read with me from the slide, and see how you feel without it. Wow! That is some impressive advanced technological approach. We can send people into space. We can move separate atoms underneath a microscope. But we're unable to accurately determine if someone is intolerant to a compound present in bread, pizza, cookies, and whatnot. Now, imagine an approach that would be worthy of the 21st century. We go to the supermarket and make our way to the section where they sell medicines and vitamins. Usually in that section, you can also find pregnancy tests. What is easier than buying a small device, peeing on it, and just reading out the results? What if you could buy such a test, not only for gluten intolerance, but also cat allergy and other allergies? What if you could bring a small tester with you when you go hiking to test for Lyme disease when you've been bitten by a tick? The reality is that currently blood tests are most common to determine if you have an allergy or a disease. Maybe some of you have experienced this. So the first step is to, you know, make an appointment and go to the doctor and have some of your blood collected. And then they have your blood and the fun begins. Your sample grows through a lengthy process with various analytical steps, but in the end some result that the doctor can interpret. And finally, the doctor can come and tell you that you might be a little allergic to almost everything they tested, as happened to a friend of mine. So, obviously, the current method has some drawbacks. Firstly, you need to actually go to the doctor, which is not that convenient when you're in the middle of a hike. Furthermore, the method also takes quite a long time. The tests themselves take a couple of hours, and it's usually days until you get back your results. For me, the biggest problem was that I wasn't allowed to eat anything beforehand, and I almost passed out because I was so hungry. Some people are uncomfortable with all these barriers, and thus have their blood tested too late or not at all. And especially in cases such as Lyme disease, this can cause some serious health issues. If the infection is not detected and treated in time, you might end up in a wheelchair for the remainder of your life, experiencing excruciating joint pains. Now, I'm a student here at the Delft University of Technology, and I'm part of a team participating in a worldwide competition. And it is our dream to realize the simple but sophisticated test I mentioned before for allergies and diseases. I hope by now you understand why it is so important to improve the current methods and that we have your full support. There's just this tiny aspect of our project that will probably make you a little less supportive. That's the fact that it's based on a genetically modified bacterium. What? Genetic modification is a scary subject, and people usually freak out a little when this topic is mentioned, or synthetic biology in general is mentioned. So I'd like to examine it a little further. Now, as a kid I was, and I still am, a very passionate reader. The Harry Potter books, the Da Vinci Code series, Stephen King thrillers. I read them all. And sometimes I would get so lost in a story that I could not shake it off me while already in bed. And then this funny thing happens, something most of us have experienced at some point in our lives. You start to imagine monsters under your bed. Without an actual cause to be afraid, your brain comes up with these very creative, scary thoughts. Now, we're all adults here and we can laugh at these little childish problems. I mean, come on, monsters under the bed? We've grown over troubles like that. Or have we? I think synthetic biology is kind of the adult version of the monster under the bed. We read something about it in a newspaper and it gives us this uneasy feeling without actually knowing what it is. Mostly, I think, it's a fear of the unknown. If you go onto the street and ask random passersby what they know about and think of synthetic biology, the answers are usually a little vague. Like, I've heard people calling it manipulation of nature. This is often mentioned in combination with GMO plants. Now, it is especially terms like manipulation that have this negative ring to it. I'd like to step back from these negative vibes and get back to the core. Synthetic biology, what is it? Now, we live in the 21st century, so we can just look up a definition online. But this just results in some very elaborate sentences that actually explain very little. So I'd like to use iGEM as an example. iGEM is the worldwide competition I mentioned before, and iGEM stands for International Genetically Engineered Machines. On the iGEM website, it says, for over 10 years, we've been encouraging students to work together to solve real-world challenges by building genetically engineered biological systems with standard interchangeable parts. Now, a core compound of synthetic biology, and actually all of us, is DNA, the code in our cells that forms the blueprint for what we look like and for all cellular processes. Some of the techniques we employ involve genetic engineering, which comes down to the cutting and pasting of this DNA. Additionally, we can also read DNA codes and write DNA sequences ourselves. However, I can imagine this to still be a little vague. So let's discuss the three things that biological systems are very good at, which is making, breaking, and detecting. For example, there was this iGEM team that focused on creating an alternative way for the production of an anti-malarial drug. So that's making. Another team focused on obtaining a protein able to efficiently and quickly degrade plastic to treat, for example, the plastic soup in the ocean. Breaking. Last but not least, we hope that our simple but sophisticated test can be used to detect antibiotic-resistant bacteria so that the antibiotic usage can be adapted accordingly. Now, as you've probably noticed, I am a student in the synthetic biology field, so of course I think it can be useful. However, I'm also very aware of the risks that go paired with genetic engineering. I mean, we can actually change DNA. With the wrong intention, this can cause some serious health risks. Let's compare it to a pair of scissors. As it just so happens, I have a pair with me. Now, as a child, we all learned that we should not run around while carrying a pair, and that if we really have to walk with them, we should do it like this, right? And we don't start out by using the real thing, too. I still remember the struggles, too, when I tried to cut anything with blunt, childproof scissors. My point is, a pair of scissors can be dangerous, but when they are used responsibly, they form a very handy, valuable tool. And the exact same thing is true for synthetic biology. There is, of course, this one difference. And that is that it is easier for you to trust me with this pair of scissors than it is for you to trust me with synthetic biology. Why? Well, if I go walking around like this with my pair of scissors, you all know I am doing it wrong. because you have been taught how to carry them as well. However, in the case of synthetic biology, it's much more unlikely that you can tell when I'm making a mistake. Most of you are not familiar with the safety rules I've been taught to practice synthetic biology responsibly. Yet, should this stop us from curing diseases, saving environments, and generally trying to make the world a better place? I hope you agree with me that synthetic biology can be of huge benefit to all humankind. Yes, there are risks, but as long as it's practiced responsibly, it poses no threat to us. In that sense, our fear of the unknown might actually be a bigger threat than synthetic biology itself. To quote from Dan Brown's Inferno, only one form of contagion travels faster than a virus, and that's fear. So, I hope you all sleep well tonight. The monsters under your bed are just shadows, and we can shine a light on them. Thank you.